Good evening. Join me for the pledge.
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Welcome to the April 13th Selectmen's Meeting. Tonight, we're going to start with a public hearing under provision of RSA 31:95-B, number 3A. To apply for, accept, and expand unanticipated monies in the amount of $10,000 or more under the following programs in 2015, New Hampshire State Homeland Security Program, New Hampshire Department of Safety, Public Safety Communications,
Interoperability. Yeah, it's a mouthful.
Interoperability grants, law enforcement, terrorism prevention program, homeland security, exercise and evaluation grants, radiological emergency response grants, emergency management performance grants, United States Fire Administration grants, assistant to firefighter grants, staffing for adequate fire and emergency response grants, fire prevention and safety grants, coastal flood hazards and climate change, coastal resiliency grants, aquatic resource mitigation, FEMA hazard mitigation grant, flood mitigation assistance grant, repetitive flood claim, severe repetitive loss, pre-disaster mitigation grant, assistance program for New Hampshire coastal zone communities, New Hampshire Highway Safety Agency, New Hampshire Division of Historical Resources, LCHIP grant program, U.S. Department of Justice, and Office of Justice Programs.
That's a mouthful.
I guess. Would you like to tell us a little bit about that, Fred?
I would, Mr. Chairman. I realize it's a mouthful reading through that. It certainly is. These are the grants that we normally receive each and every year. And as opposed to having to advertise, we have to advertise by law because they're $10,000 or more. As opposed to having one advertisement for each of these grants, what we did is we put it into one advertisement so we're covered for the whole year. The grant comes in and you approve it and it can be expended. That's the purpose.
Okay, do we have some, we want to start with public comment, right?
Please, sir.
Public comment? No one has any comment on all of these grants? This is
no
a lot of money.
No, hopefully. Public hearing? You opening the public hearing?
Yes, oh. We already did.
Okay, I just.
So seeing none, we'll come back to the board. Mr. Bridle?
No, I think it's a good idea to put them all together. It takes up a lot of time every time you have to have one of these. A public hearing for every one of these, so I think we've lumped them all in together, and I think it's going to save us some time, so got no problem with it.
Mrs. Wellesley?
So, Mr. Welch, our departments can apply for any or all of these grants, and there's a minimum of $10,000 that's open for us to receive in the grant process.
Well, the statute says if it's $10,000 or more, we must hold a public hearing.
Right.
And we must advertise it, and that's what's been done for each one of these, right. In case they're $10,000 or more. Some of them are less, and in situations like that where they come in pieces, okay. They're covered with this as well.
Okay. So the potential for numerous grants.
There are.
Good.
Mr. Bean?
I have no questions, Mr. Chairman.
And Mr. Waddell? So in the past, we would have done these all separately.
That's correct.
At the same time of the year or different times of the year?
Throughout the entire year. These are the grants we would normally receive during the course of a calendar year. And we would pay our wonderful newspaper to advertise them every time they came out. So we're saving some money for the advertising is what we're doing.
And do we expect to make some of these come?
We expect to see the majority of these actually come through this year.
Okay, great. Next, we
pursuant to the public hearing being closed at whatever time it is, I'll move that we accept, subsequent to the public hearing, the provisions of RSA 31:95 as stated for the grants.
Second.
So, any further discussion? All those in favor? Unanimous. Moving on to public comment.
Good evening. Richard Rennie of 29 Highland Ave. This past Friday's Hampton Union had an article about this board's meeting to discuss goals, problems, and solutions for 2015. And I quote just one paragraph from that article. Selectman Jim Wardell and Rusty Bridle said the town should do more to educate residents about what employees do for the town. Wardell said social media would be an effective way to showcase the valuable employees of the town. I think it's an excellent idea. Since we have our state reps here tonight, permit me to showcase their valuable contributions to the community. There was an article here in the Seacoast Sunday. 25 Seacoast legislators have perfect records. And I'm just going to read one paragraph from there. Elected every 2 years, with each member receiving $100. Now, there's an incentive for re-election, isn't it? The legislative workload includes reviewing about 1,000 bills, plus researching, sponsoring, and speaking on legislation. Most of the 400 House members serve on at least one of nearly 24 committees that hold hearings, sometimes lasting several hours, on each bill referred to it. Most of the 24 senators serve on two or more committees. In addition, House members serve on county delegations, requiring work and meetings on annual budgets that allocate funding for jails, nursing homes, the county attorney, and sheriff's department, and also here tonight, and I don't think they're on overtime. Okay. So back to that article about the 25 legislators. There have been 100 roll calls in the House so far this year. Our representative's record, 100%, Robert Rene Cushing. 99%, Tracy Emmerich and Fred Rice. 92%, Dave Wood. Missed 8 roll calls in one day. What was that, a snow day, Dave? Probably. Okay, well, 92%. That's great, right? The Senate, 52 roll calls this year, 100%, Senator Nancy Stiles. So I'm here to say thank you for your dedicated commitment to your position as this community's voices in Concord. Thank you.
Thank you. Other public comment this evening? Seeing none, we'll move on to announcements and community calendar. Mr. Bridle?
I have nothing tonight. Thank you.
Mrs. Wellesley?
Ladies and gentlemen, check the town website for updated information on the Rain Garden project, or call our conservation coordinator, Rayanne Dion, at the town office for an update.
Mr. Bean and Mr. Wardell.
2 days of spring. It's great. And the mountain at the state park beach is going away.
Not very quickly, though.
It's going.
Yeah. Moving on to the consent agenda. We have many veteran tax credit requalifications. We have an entertainment license for Ron's Landing. We have some appointments for different committees. We have New Hampshire surplus distribution section authorization, and we have the HAN use of town offices for art display, Hampton Arts.
Mr. Chairman, I'd be happy to move the consent agenda, but I think we need to read out the appointments to the different committees so people know who's being reappointed or newly appointed.
Would you like to read them?
I'm happy to do that. Reappointments on the cable committee, Bill Lowney. Conservation, Jay Diener, Sharon Raymond, and Gordon Vintner, with an alternate, Tony Schialfi. Energy, Withka and Betts. Highway Safety, Larry Douglas. Leased Land, Tom McGurk. Mosquito, Ann Kaiser, and Recreation, Kim Warburton and Craig.
You also have Lee Lowney for the Cable Committee.
Okay, I couldn't tell whether that was Bill or Lee. It
it's
just
both.
Says Lowney. It's both. Good. Thank you. And I'll be happy to move the consent agenda.
Second.
All those in favor? Unanimous. Moving on to the approval of minutes for March 30th, 2015.
Also move.
Second.
All those in favor? Unanimous. Next, we have our appointments. First is going to be State Senator and representatives from the legislative delegation. Please join us at the table. I will tell you that I spoke with Senator Stiles this morning, and she's got a really not, she's not really feeling well, so she couldn't join us here tonight, but she's going to come and join us again in the future.
She informed me that she had double pneumonia and spent 5 hours in the hospital last night. And
didn't want to say that.
Her first duty tonight ought to be to take care of herself.
That's what I
sent her an email and told her to try burning the candle at only one end. It might work a little bit better. Because she is really a workhorse. She does an awful lot of stuff.
I think she's recently been on a plane, and that sometimes people catch things right. like that on a plane. So,
Mr. Chairman, how would you like to proceed on this?
Well,
do you want to ask us? Do you want us to ask you? Or
I think that if you each introduce yourselves, and then what would the board like?
Why don't you introduce yourselves and tell us what committee you're on?
Okay. Right.
And then maybe we'll find out about some of the legislation that you guys have proposed or anything we have.
So, Mr.
I'm Andrew Christie, and I represent Hampton, Hampton Falls, and Seabrook, and I'm the chairman of the Executive Departments and Administration Committee.
Also known as SPIS.
That's true.
Tracy Emmerich, I represent Hampton, and I'm on Finance.
Fred Rice, represent Hampton, and I'm on Resources, Recreation, and Development.
Randy Cushing from Hampton, I'm on the Criminal Justice and Public Safety Committee.
Hi, I'm Dave Wood from Hampton, and I'm on the Public Works and Highways, which deals with the capital side of the budget.
Why don't we start with Rennie Cushing, 100%.
Wow, thank you. Thank you. I was really touched by that. No one ever says thank you or acknowledges
yeah,
you. Something.
That
catches me by surprise. So thank you. I don't know, you know, where to begin. I will tell you that some of the individual pieces of legislation that I've worked, that I'm working on, partly that relate to my committee. I'm sponsoring a bill that would require people convicted of violent crimes to appear in courtroom during the time that their sentence is imposed and that the time that victims are delivering a victim impact statement, because I think it's part of a, it has a lot to do with justice, and it provides a place for victims in our criminal justice system, which often isn't there. I also sponsored legislation I've been working on for a number of years that is somewhat controversial, but in an attempt to try to preserve what's left of our traditional recreation and commercial fishing industries, I've introduced a bill that would prevent a local a change in the character of a neighborhood or economics from basically putting people who are small fishing operations out of business. The times when people who worked on the water, lived on the water, are long gone. I think we recognize that. And to my thinking, there's not much difference between someone who takes a laptop home and someone who takes a lobster trap home, really. It's the idea that, you know, these are small operations that we ought to not have people zone folks who work on the water out of business. And that passed the House. We'll see how it goes in the Senate. I also, on my committee, I work a lot with victims, you know, of crime, and one of the things that's taken place is in the past year, last year there were 1,131 adults who sought shelter at domestic violence centers in the state and were turned away because there's just no room. We haven't increased the state contribution from marriage license fees since 1992 to support the 13 shelters of domestic violence. You know, domestic violence is the half the homicides in the state are as a result of that. 92% are from the murder suicides are there. So I, you know, sponsored legislation to try and to add $5 to the marriage license fee to try to support that. And those are, you know, some of the just kind of things I put a fair amount. And as the committee is aware, I try to take a lead in putting an end to corporate welfare and trying to make sure that that those who, you know, can manage to get sweetheart deals through the legislature to mandate that communities such as Hampton have to forego the ability to collect property taxes. That's continues to be a hard sell, and it also affects not just the, you know, not just the town of Hampton, but it also affects the state
you may know, we don't have that much money in the state coffers right now. And while it's $500,000 a year to Hampton, it's $7.2 million a year to the State Education Trust Fund. And at a time when we're looking around to support public education, the idea that we're not asking everybody to pay their fair share is just, it's a, you know, it's absurd to me. And, you know, our, as a delegation, we've worked on that. Anyhow, I don't want to talk too much, but I'll be glad to speak more and pass it on to other people.
Okay. Mr. Waddell, would you like to ask Representative Cushing some?
Sure. No. First of all, thank you guys.
Yeah.
And I mean, I was up there too at one time, and the public, these guys put in a lot of time. What Richard said is absolutely true. A lot of time for a little compensation, and when people say thank you, I think it's a big deal to them.
It's a real
and
deal.
Thank you, Rennie, for a lot of the stuff that you do. And you know, most important to me is the relationship between the state and the town, and the financial relationship between the state and the town, because that's what affects the taxpayers the most.
Right.
And I know you've done a lot of work on the pollution control bill. And I really want to thank you for that. And I think that's a really important bill that somehow we get through, because it does mean a lot of money to the town, and it does mean a lot of money to the state. So thank you very much for that. And I'm going to pass on that.
Thanks, Jim.
Mr. Bridle?
No, I don't have any in particular for Rennie. I just thank you for your work. I know I, too, spent a number of years in Concord.
You got rich up there at $100
a
year.
Yeah, you know, I spent 10 years up there, so
tax.
I made about $1,000 in 10 years. So it is. It's a many times a thankless job. But personally, it was very rewarding.
Yeah,
I learned a lot about our state. I was able to bring back some stuff for the town. But it's like herding cats. And to try to bring something back for a particular area, we know is very hard. And I just want to thank you guys for continuing to represent us up there.
Mrs. Wolseley?
Welcome, Representative Christie.
Thank you.
And all of you gentlemen, thank you for what you do, because it has to be a really trying process. Rennie, I especially admire your advocacy in the criminal justice system, truly. I appreciate that.
Thank you.
And for your fighting on the pollution control.
Thank you very much.
Fairness. Thank you so much.
Mr. Bean?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Good evening, gentlemen. I received your March 26th email on 224, which, of course, is pollution control.
Right.
You know, it's $500,000 now, but we don't know when that pilot program ends, if the bottom's going to fall out on that. Could you please tell us from your side where this is going? We're getting USAIDs not only for shared revenue. If you look at our line here, 6010 from the state of New Hampshire, our shared revenue is zero. We have a tremendous revenue camp for the state at about $200 million. I have the full documentation for tolls. I've got the full documentation for what goes on at the liquor stores. Rooms and meals, of course, is the big secret in a transparent government. But getting back to something we're engaged in a fight with right now, and again, come up good with Agusa. Where are we going on 224, and how do we stop a $15 billion corporation named NextEra and taking $500,000 a year from taxpayers that's lined up with the state of New Hampshire that's a $5 billion corporation for this little $26 million corporation? And how do we get Hampton taxpayers' money in their own pockets?
I mean, it's a long conversation, but I think the only way you do it is you have to build alliances with other communities. And one of the things that has to really, there's no counterbalance in the legislature that's coming from the bottom up on lawmakers from other jurisdictions. And people don't, it's been defined as, well, you know, you're anti-business if you want fair business taxes. And it's being, you know, there just is not a critical mass of people in other communities, in other counties, who are going to be part of it. And I think the way that you have to do that is, to a certain extent, I think you have to reach out to your peers and initiate, you know, selectmen to selectmen meetings in the towns that are directly, that are, you know, in the communities that are affected by that. That's one way. And the other thing is, you need to make, you know, start building alliances with organizations in this. You know, you have the municipal association that's really strong on it, but there are some other people who need to be stepping up, because it's not just the town that's losing, it's the fact that, you know, it's costing the state $7.2 billion in this biennium alone. That should be enough to get people's attention. But again, what happened is, we had House Bill 224. I tried to do a floor amendment to the budget that was ruled out of order by the Speaker. I felt, I'm not going to challenge the Speaker on it because I'm not going to win a procedural vote on it. As it goes into the Senate, I would think that some of the Senate budget writers might take a look at closing tax loopholes. This is such an egregious tax loophole that it's not like it's creating a new tax. It's just making people who aren't paying their fair share pay their fair share. Other than that,
if I may, this
no, I'd like yeah. to direct, I'm asking the representative some okay. questions, please. Thank you. Commissioner Rose,
mm-hmm.
a former public affairs speaker for BAE Systems, an international right. defense firm, sent in written testimony when you presented your 224.
Right.
Were you given a heads up that he was going to do that?
No.
Okay. Collectively, as the delegation sought an audience with Commissioner Rose to address protocol number one, and number two, have a sit down with that meeting. He meets all the time with people. They're at what I call dog and ponies, Chamber of Commerce cutting the ribbons. But I would think, with a blind side like that, that our delegation, all of you gentlemen, would be demanding an audience with him and an explanation for that and going forward in the future. What's the protocol and why is that going on?
I actually want to say that there's another figure that leaps out at me, and that's another broken promise that took place in this budget process, that the legislature, the House, broke its promise to the tourism industry because it cut the 3.3% of the meals and rooms tax that was being dedicated to promote the tourism industry, beyond the state, which actually returned $9 to the state for every $1 you did. But the budget just cut $7.2 or $7.3 million of advertising for the tourist industry out of it, which is incredibly short-sighted. It just happens to be the same amount of money, interestingly enough, around $7.3, that Commissioner Rose said that the state didn't have to bother to collect for the Education Trust Fund. I'm a little frustrated by that. On the one hand, they won't collect money. On the other hand, why is economic development, or Dredd suddenly decided that it didn't want to fight for tourism advertising dollars? Because obviously, in this community, the health and vitality of the tourism industry, the hospitality industry, has a direct bearing on our local economy and the rest
point,
of the state.
And in his letter that he sent, without informing the delegation, he taught that the way forward for business in New Hampshire was to give tax breaks, in this case, to multi-billion dollar corporations. He didn't talk about the value of the people in the state, the value of the proximity to Europe, to the West Coast, to universities, to healthcare. He didn't talk about small business. He didn't talk about quality of life. He didn't talk about the mountains. He didn't talk about the lakes. He didn't talk about Hampton Beach. He just thinks that, and according to his own words, that the way to foster business in this state, and again, I'm paraphrasing his letter, is to give tax breaks to multi-billion dollar corporations. And I'd like your sentiments on that, please.
I think everybody should pay their taxes fairly, that's all. I mean, it's tax fairness, that's what it is.
Well, I know I don't speak for the board, but I would think,
by other
because
colleagues.
You were the spearhead on this, I would think that this delegation should request a meeting with the commissioner and have this kind of conversation, mm-hmm. because I think it would be helpful for him. And I think when you talk about building a consensus, I think the first thing to do is get the commissioner in line with reality. That's just my opinion. Thanks.
And I also would like to thank you, Representative Cushing. You've done a lot. You started out at the beginning. It took a while to figure out if you were really going to be there, but we've seen your name all over the place. And we appreciate it. You've worked very hard, and I noticed over there in Hampton Falls you had that little thing going on over there, but I think that you looked, you held up very well to do what you've been doing, and we appreciate it.
Thank you.
And Mr. Representative Rice?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. As I mentioned, I serve on the Resources Recreation Development Committee. I spent two terms on the Commerce and Consumer Affairs Committee. And that is, as you guys know, that is a workload. We saw 80, 90 bills a year. And many extra days, many extra hours. The Commerce Committee wasn't halfway through when the committee I'm on now, Resources, was completely through of the House bills. So the workload is a little bit different. I welcome the breather because it gave me a chance to get out into other areas and try to do some stuff, including doing some of the research with Rennie on this. We've been working pretty closely on this, and it's been a real pleasure to work with Rennie. I've mentioned before when we've come here to report to you folks that a lot of people don't realize about 80% of what we do up there is totally nonpartisan. There's a big consent calendar. There's a lot of stuff that everybody agrees on. The committee recommendations are overwhelming. You get a little bit of back and forth on the floor. But by and large, most of the votes are pretty solid on most of the issues. The few that are contentious take up 90% of the oxygen in the room, however. And some of the bills that I've been working on, I prime sponsored 5 bills, and I was a co-sponsor on 16. I did that because other people came to me and said, would you be on this bill with me? A lot of those were things having to do with the Veterans Home and things of that nature. Some of the prime sponsored ones that I worked on, one was Jerry McConnell last term came to me and said, why can't I bring my wife's absentee ballot up here to the town clerk? I take it to her and she says, I can't take it from you. You got to put it in the mailbox. He said, that's stupid. I'm already here. You know me. You know my wife. We tried to put it in last year. It got to be very, very complex. It's amazing how much complexity people on the committees up there can put into this stuff. And the committee itself tried to help. Then it got, and we passed it in the House. Then it went over to the Senate, and one senator, and I won't mention who he was, but he added in some language in there that made it even more complex, so that when it came back for the committee of conference, there was no agreement. They couldn't reach agreement. The House felt that the Senate had gone too far and made it far too complex. The Senate representatives felt that it wasn't complex enough or wasn't secure enough, so it died. This year, I put the same bill back in. My bill was ITL'd, inexpedient to legislate. It was killed. But another representative, Dick Marston, put one in because he had been on the committee that heard this last year. And he came in and said, let's just make it real simple. Any relative can deliver an absentee ballot. Boom. Simple, straightforward, no signatures, because the security on an absentee ballot is on the inner envelope, not the outer one. And that has gone through, and we think that it's going to make it this time. Senator Stiles, as she did before, is trying to hold the line for us over there in the Senate and make sure that this one gets through. I think it's already had a hearing over in the Senate, and we'll see what comes out on it. I'm optimistic on this one. Because I would love to be able to tell Jerry McConnell, now you can bring your wife's ballot to the clerk directly. So I hope so. Another one that I worked on was the, you mentioned before the tax exemption for veterans. And you mentioned that in your consent calendar. I introduced a piece of legislation this year that would take away all of those dates out of that. When somebody goes into the military, it's an all-volunteer service, all of the services are. But once they get in there, they have no control over where they go. They have no control over whether they're going to go into a combat zone in Afghanistan or Iraq or back in the day to Korea or Vietnam. They have no control over that. It's their superiors in the Army and the Navy, the Air Force, and so forth, that make those decisions. So when they come back out, they served honorably, but they don't get the same tax break that other people did just by luck of the draw. A good example of somebody like this is Ken Shepherd, former state rep. He served for 20 years, 4 years on active duty and 16 years in the reserve, a lot more than most people do. And he is not eligible for the veterans tax exemption on his homeowners and property tax because he didn't happen to be overseas during one of the specific calendar times. Those are calendar times for eligibility to join the Veterans of Foreign Wars, which is appropriate for them, but not for veterans. All veterans, I believe, should be treated exactly the same. So that one was retained. There's going to be a working group on it. The chairman of the Municipal and County Affairs Municipal Affairs Committee has asked if I want to be, serve on that, and I told her, absolutely. So I'm going to continue to fight for that so that we can get equal. It's the same thing as taxation. It's, I think all veterans ought to be treated the same. They volunteered, they left their homes, they went and served wherever they were told to go, on board a sub, in an airplane, in combat in a jungle, or in combat in a desert, or in an administrative job in Michigan or something. It's all the same, and I hope that they will get their equal treatment in this. Some of the other items that have come up. Selectman Bean, you mentioned this stuff with the pollution control exemption. I was kind of right along beside Rennie on all of these things, and there's a couple things. The letters that come in from departments, nobody ever knows what's going to be in there. The day of the hearing, you find out. There is no advance notice. Nobody ever does that. They come in, and you, matter of fact, you don't even know who's going to speak and appear. You walk into the hearing room. You fill out one of the little pink cards. The chairman takes it. He gives the representatives a first shot because they have a lot of other places to be. Then he'll give department agency heads the courtesy of going next, and then the general public and so forth. But nobody knows what any of them are going to say. Nobody knows what they're going to have in writing. Nobody knows whether they're going to be in favor of it or not. Then there's also a blue sheet that you can sign your name down and say whether you were in support or opposed to it. And at the end of the hearing, the committee takes those things, and those are all factors that go into their decision on it. And I'm not going to leap to anybody's defense, but I don't think it's fair to say that Rose had it out for anybody on that, because his opinion reflected the rest of the committee anyway, and we fought it. We tried like heck to fight it, but let me read you the committee report that went to the House floor. HB 224FN, repealing the exemption for water and air pollution control facilities from local property taxation. Now, when we get up there, when I spoke on the floor against repealing it, or ITL, against ITLing it, I said two main points. One, this has absolutely nothing to do with pollution control. And number two, it is not increasing anyone's taxes. Those are absolute facts. All we want to do is get rid of the exemption where they have actually been paying nothing and get them up on the same basis, mm-hmm. as Rennie just said, so that all businesses pay the same amount. Yeah. Nothing special for anybody. That was all we asked for. When we went into the hearing room, I think some of you were up there, I was blown away by the number of lobbyists that were there and where they came from. That was the thing that really got me. There were lobbyists there from the chief executive officer of NextEra was over there. But they had people there from Monadnock Paper Mills. They had people there from Anheuser-Busch. What in the world does that have to do with pollution control? And they stood up there and, in my opinion, lied through their teeth, telling the committee that they were going to have their taxes increased on all of their facilities if this bill passed. That was a bald-faced lie. I talked, and Rennie did the same thing. We talked to individual members of the committee, tried to convince them that this was not the case, and when the what they call the blurb, the thing that goes in the calendar to give the rest of the members an idea of what was discussed, it said this. The committee decided that repealing this exemption would be anti-business, and testimony from industry, not from the state, not from anybody else, from industry indicated the additional tax, which is a lie, would either be passed on to consumers or might actually cause their companies to relocate to another state. Anheuser-Busch came in and said that they would relocate their plant to Massachusetts if this passed. Now that is about as far out as you can possibly get. Needless to say, we will not. Rennie and I were not very happy about this. When it came out of the committee vote was 15-1 against us. When it went to the floor, it was on the consent calendar because there was only one vote against. And did anybody have any objection to going on the consent? No. Rennie pulled it from the consent calendar so that it could be discussed. When it was discussed, I spoke against ITLing it. Representative Cushing spoke against it, and he also took some questions. And then two representatives, Representative John Burt and Representative Jim Belanger, who was the chair of the committee who heard this, they both spoke in favor of ITLing it. I requested a roll call, but it was not sufficiently seconded. There weren't 10 people who would second this in the entire 400-member House. So it had nothing to do with Jeff Rose. It was the fact that they were totally indifferent in the whole House. The final vote, they did do a division vote, and there were 249 members voted to ITL it, and only 77 were against that. Now, this reminds me of when I was the chair of the Hampton Beach Area Commission. When we first got the okay to go forward on the seashell, the meeting after we got the final approval, and it was approved up in Concord that they would go forward, we'd gone up there and the concept was approved. I made the statement to the commission at one of the meetings that now that we have this thing, we have got to go convince the people in Littleton and Claremont and Keene and Laconia and Salem that this is just as good a deal for them as it is for us here in Hampton. Because I want to tell you folks, it may be hard to take, but to the rest of the state, Hampton is a little tiny dot down in the corner that is populated by people from Massachusetts, and they don't care about the rest of the state. That's what the people up in Coos County and over on the western side of the state express often. On this thing right here, one of the representatives from someplace up in the middle of the state, he said, this is a Hampton issue, let them take care of it. That is exactly what he said. So this is the same thing, just as Representative Cushing said, we've got to, the best thing that would happen to move this forward in another year would be to form a coalition of the towns that have facilities such as this in them. Power plants, anybody that might be subject to big tax. NHMA, bless their heart, they had this in their legislative bulletin, which I know you read faithfully, Fred. They were very, very, very supportive. Cordell Johnson was there, and he just really did a great job. I can't say enough good about what he did. But that's kind of the nuts and bolts of it. My committee was the only committee that got a full briefing from the from DRED. I don't think any other committee gets one, just because of the nature of our committee. And they gave us a full thing on tourism, and I don't think there was anything left on the table on their promotion of tourism. They put forward a program that was pretty across the board. I always had, when I was on the Commerce Committee, I had a little criticism of how I didn't think that the tourism people over at DRED did enough. But they gave us a pretty full briefing, and I think that they do a pretty adequate job within their scope. It's not all their job to bring businesses here, and it's not all the tourism that brings it here. I think that there's a pretty good consensus that a lowering of business, we have the most oppressive business taxes in the country. We're like number 48, 49, or 50. And I think that if we do lower the business taxes, but that's a different subject from this. It's a totally different subject. But if we did lower the business taxes, I think we would have an opportunity to attract more businesses here.
Questions for Representative Rice. Mr. Wardell?
Yeah, just very quickly, I'll just respond to Fred and Rennie on the tax exemption. And I think we all should pay attention to this and what they're saying. We should pay attention to that partially the fault is ours, too. I mean, talking about getting a coalition together, talking about getting other towns and stuff. I mean, we send our representatives up to Concord, and then we expect them to get things done immediately. But did enough towns go up and outweigh the other testimony that was against it?
Hampton's the only town that does this.
That's
a credit to you.
Yeah.
Because that's.
Yeah. But we need to get out, and we need to get more people. I mean, I think. I agree with Phil, we get angry at the state and stuff, but throwing sticks and stones and calling names, it doesn't work. And because somebody testifies against it, just going against them, I think it's a coalition of the towns, the municipal association does a good job, and we have to do more of our homework to get people to go along with what you guys, to go along and see what the exemption is. I remember when I was up at that testimony, I was there, I think. And Londonderry was in favor of it, right?
I think he was, that was the only one, that was
and
the only
I couldn't
vote
believe
that.
Because sometimes people equate the interest of a particular business within the community instead of the interest of the taxpayers of the community.
Yeah.
I'm just saying that, that not everybody, but sometimes it's just, you know, that's understandable.
But in the, you know, in the, you know, with time here and stuff, that's all I have to say on it. And I think we ought to limit the time each one of us speaks here. We'll then be here all night.
Sorry.
That's just my suggestion.
Mr. Bridle.
I'm all set. I'll save you time.
Mrs. Wolseley.
Do you have the patience of Job?
Just got to be persistent. Sometimes you win. Sometimes you lose. You keep fighting the battle, and you hope that you're going to come out on top. But you got to convince an awful lot of people.
You're very brave men.
Further comments, Mr. Bean?
Yeah, Representative Rice, great work. I know you're right up there arm in arm with your brethren from the left that's on the right of you tonight.
He's sitting on my right, by the way. Did you notice that?
You put him over there.
And doing your thing.
I like having Fred to the left of me.
Ain't going to happen often.
And it is the incipient stages of this. Last year, there was perhaps a better choreographed effort, and there were more municipalities. Portsmouth was up there. Fred and I were up there. And it was much better choreographed and produced than it was this year. And let me just finish. You know our opinions. Jim and I went up, met with Cordell. Cordell quarterbacked this whole thing with you, Andy.
He
did an excellent
and
job.
He is the lobbyist, and this is ground zero. And we got a goose egg. But I think that I think other people know, and this is just my feeling, having been up to Concord four or five times, that other people know. That a letter's coming from the commissioner, and we don't know. And I think going forward, when you talk about the lobbyists, and I'm not saying lobbyists are bad, because they're paid to present their interests, and we have Cordell, and we have our interests.
They educate us, but they're selling something.
Yes,
we have to understand both sides of that.
So issue. I think if we expand the net in terms of who we know is our adversary in the most benign sense, as we forge legislation, or you do rather, we check the box, what does Rose say? What does Ways and Means do? And that's a simple check. And what is your position on it? And going forward next year when it comes up again, I know you're going to do that. Mm-hmm. And I know Cordell's going to do that.
I don't know about Reddy, but I was blindsided by the response within the committee. No way did I expect that big a response on the opposite side. I really did not.
Yes, sir. And so I've been up there about four or five times, mostly with Fred, with Jim, and these two have been up there serving for years and years, and you guys do great work, and you can read the tea leaves, you see what's going on. Appreciate it. But let's work with Cordell, go forward on this one. This is $500,000 a year.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And we don't know, when this agreement ends, we don't know where it's going.
We did pick up some support. I mean, Berlin weighed in this year, so it was like Coos County came on board. They were really good about it. I mean, if a municipality will weigh in, step up, talk to the legislative delegation, make sure they get it, then they'll respond. But otherwise, it's just, you know.
We talked to every single person, every single municipality before that hearing. We didn't get much time between the time the bill was filed and the hearing was called. Mm-hmm. But we talked to every single one of them. And I don't believe any of them other than Londonderry turned us down to say that they would talk to their representatives and they would send a letter.
See, we can't resubmit this now because it's the same subject. But if we could come at it from a totally different angle, then we could. And if we were to try and do that,
well, we'll figure out a way or something.
I know Rennie's
dead. We'll have another conversation next year, Fred, about this.
Thank you, Representative Rice. We, you know, I speak for the board too. I appreciate it.
We're trying to get there.
And Representative
Emmerich.
Well, this time, last term I was on labor, and this time I decided I wanted to see how the thing really works. So I went on finance. And I'm like the proverbial dog who caught the bus. Finance meets pretty much 5 days a week until about now to get the budget done. And you've all heard about the budget, the pros and cons, they love it, they hate it. The budget actually consists of two documents. One's called HB1, House Bill 1, and that's where all the numbers are. HB2 is where all the laws are. The budget actually contains approximately 350 laws. To make the numbers work. So a law can go on the books as a result of HB2 all by itself. Something can come out from outer space, land as a New Hampshire state law, and it gets voted in the budget. So that was kind of a surprise to find out how that works. Talk about making the sausage. But the problem that we had this time was that the state was facing two lawsuits and a change in Medicaid to the tune of about $120 million. The state lost a mental health case where we have to put up approximately $40 million additional dollars, and it's being distributed around the state in local health care centers for mental health. There was a little funny tax called the medical enterprise tax, which was a sleight of hand where the state taxed the hospitals. The hospitals gave the state the money, the state gave the money back to the hospitals, and then it became matched Medicaid funds. And so the government kind of caught on to that one and said, you can't do that anymore. So we have a liability of about $42 million that we have to pay back to the hospitals. There was also a change in Medicaid, which I don't fully understand. I mean, it's one of these things that's going on, you know, at the grassroots level, the data level, that cost the state about an additional $40 million going forward. So that, plus the governor's budget, was much higher than what the forecast. Ways and Means, the committee that sets the forecast for how much revenue we're going to have, Ways and Means, came in with $11.2 million is what was available to spend. The finance committee set about spending just $11.2 million. So we actually had to cut about $325 million out of the governor's budget.
In addition, $11.2
billion. $11.2 billion. I'm sorry, did I say million?
Yeah,
you said no, it's a billion word. So there was the committee I served on, a subcommittee is called Division One. We actually handled the budgets for 35 departments. Including DRED, just as an interesting sidelight. I won't get into all the details, but the commissioner was not very cooperative with the budget committee. So we kind of gave him a choice of, you know, you can either lay off people or we can find out what's going to hurt you the least. And the advertising that was cut actually is for Canada and New York. I mean, it was for the second tier advertising. It wasn't the primary zone. Areas that do affect the town of Hampton, the room and meals tax in the governor's budget was frozen at fiscal 15 levels for FY16. Division One voted and is going to continue through FY16 and 17. So the current 600,000 and change that comes to room and meals tax to Hampton will stay at that $600,000 plus or minus whatever it is. The additional funds that are not going to come to the cities and towns was $3 million in FY16 and $9 million in FY17. The state police detail was cut by half. Mm-hmm. I don't know how
at
that.
At Hampton Beach.
At Hampton Beach, yeah, I'm sorry. At Hampton Beach, the police detail was cut by half. The block grants from the Department of Transportation are going to be pretty much unchanged. All the block grants you were due are still going to go to the cities and towns. There was supposed to be additional funds in last term's 4.2% gas tax increase. There was supposed to be additional funds to the cities and towns for roads. What the Department of Transportation did is they took those funds that came out of that 4.2 cents and substituted the general fund dollars that they normally give to cities and towns and called that the donation to cities and towns. So it wasn't, as the legislators passed it, it was supposed to be on top of general funds. They did it in lieu of general funds. So I think the cities and towns are getting about the same that they were. The Department of Transportation was cut for about $20 million overall. You've heard a lot about the education funds. The state spends approximately $900 million a year on education. Of that, $150 million is called stabilization. And in 2009, the formula changed on how cities and towns are reimbursed on a per student basis. So they introduced the stabilization, and it was supposed to be a temporary stabilizing effect. It's still on the books. And so this next biennium in 2017, the stabilization is going to start being reduced by 10%. Hampton gets no stabilization funds, so it's not going to affect Hampton at all. Cities like Manchester get $20-30 million. I mean, 10% is still $2 million, but I mean they're getting a lot of the stabilization dollars. The total stabilization, $150 million, will be legislation introduced in the next year that's going to take that down to zero, because that's funds that were quote temporary, but it's become part of life for a lot of cities and towns. Some areas that got a lot of press were the quote slashing reductions in developmentally disabled funding. Just a little background: in FY14, the DD was spent a budget at $118 million. We're in FY15 now, so we don't know exactly what it's going to be, but it could be somewhere around $120, $125 million. The governor's budget was for $142 million going forward. The House Finance Committee reduced that to $131 million. So while it sounds like it's getting slash and burn for developmentally disabled, it's actually an increase. But it's less than the governor's budget. So a lot of this PR that you hear about how we're cutting everybody's budget, we're spending more money than we spent the last biennium. And we're in instances like this where there's actually more money being allocated, but because we didn't do what the governor said, everybody thinks we're slashing and burning, which is just not the case. There will be an effect. The state, as of December 31st, was behind by about $58 million. So the governor's been scrambling to try to find ways to make up the $58 million shortfall. It's primarily coming out of Health and Human Services. Health and Human Services is behind this curtain, and it spends about half of the state's budget goes to Health and Human Services. Of that, half of that is Medicaid. So a lot of this is things that are going on that I don't know if anybody is really in charge. The processes are in place, but I don't know who's in. I don't think there's anybody riding this horse. I think it's just kind of galloping along. That's why we're $58 million in the hole. So there's a $7 million holdback that the state is going to keep the funds that were supposed to go to the county nursing homes. And that's been got a little bit of press here and there. Whether that's going to continue on, we don't know. That's the situation right now. So part of that $58 million was made up by $7 million not going to the county nursing homes. What that means is the county nursing home then has to increase the county taxes in order to cover their overhead. So we get it in the neck somewhere along the line. I mean, it's exciting. Other issues that are pressing, the budget that was passed in the House had only one fee increase, no additional taxes, but it had a fee increase of $4 for vanity plates. Vanity plates went from $40 to $43. The $3 generates a couple hundred thousand dollars, which are going to be used to hire two more detectives in safety, cold case and whatever detectives do. Now, what happens is once the budget goes over to the Senate, they know better what's going on in fiscal 15 than the House does. The Ways and Means had to set their forecast by the end of February, and they're doing it on by gosh and by golly. I mean, we think we're going to do this, we think we're going to do that. Once it goes over to the Senate now has reality. They're going to hold on to this through May, and so they're going to get all the tax collection, which happens a lot of it in April and in May, so they're going to have a better idea of actually how much funds are going to come into the state. So the budget for the future could be reallocated, rebudgeted, whatever. Because part of the funding mechanism was to wipe out the rainy day fund of about $10 million. So that got wiped out. And it was also a dedicated fund as a result of Reggie, which was about $50 million, which was being used for energy conservation. Like Walmart re-insulated their building as part of that fund and things of that nature. So all the funds that have been allocated are not being spent, but there's a lot of unallocated funds because the state is actually making some fairly good money off the Reggie project. That's where this $50 million came from. All of a sudden, here's a dedicated fund with $50 million in it. The state has about 330 dedicated funds, and trying to keep track of those has become almost a full part-time job. And about every 2 or 3 years, you go back into them and look at them, and that's why this one with the $50 million, all of a sudden it's like, wow, where did this come from? It was like manna from heaven. But right now the budget's in the Senate, and we'll see what they're going to do with it.
Thank you. Mr. Wardell?
Yeah, just quickly, in the interest of time, it's complicated. Probably a lot of what you just said went boom, right over people's heads. They're wondering what the heck goes on. It's a tough budget to do. My interest is the relationship between the state and the towns. Mm-hmm. And eventually somebody's going to pay. So you can say all you want to that we're not raising fees or taxes. And then we'll have to say, but we're raising property taxes. Mm-hmm. Well, the taxpayer is paying. So I think we really, really have to be careful about that, and we have to work together to not have that happen, to have the state take up their responsibilities, the town take up their responsibilities, and do it in a rational and intelligent manner. So that's all I've...
I'll make a comment to that.
Downshift.
Right, very quickly.
Downshifting.
I'm a co-sponsor of a bill for video lottery, which actually are video slot machines, but calling it video lottery earmarks the money for education. If it's implemented, we use the Oregon model of six machines per location that has a liquor license, has to be in a separate room, nobody under 21, on and on. It generates about $212 million a year. That is 100% to offset property taxes. 100% of that money, it can't grow government. It goes into the education fund in order to offset property taxes. So to that point, I'm working on trying to get the property taxes down from a different direction.
Does it happen with the town that they're in? Or does it go into a fund that gets
statewide
distributed? So if there were those video machines, would the ones in Hampton go to Hampton, or do they go?
They go into a into
that's the problem.
Well, we can rewrite the bill.
But see,
one of the things on here is that at the town level, when you first decide what you're going to spend, and then you raise the taxes to cover that amount of expense that you have. That's the way it works at this level. At the federal level, they decide what they want to spend, and then they raise the taxes or print more money. The state is in between, and they can't do either of those things. At the state level, they can only spend legally what they are going to bring in. You can't, by law, you have to balance the budget. So you can't deficit spend. So that's where you have. So you've got limited resources. When everybody says you're cutting, no, we're staying within what we have to spend with. The same as you do at home. You can't spend any more than the money than your income.
Mr. Bridle,
so that's
questions
for
Mr.
Just a comment is, yeah, that's in fact true. But you have some towns, cities and towns that don't want to do anything to promote either the tourist industry or anything else. And then you have other towns like Hampton that produce a lot of tourists and industry. So it tends to cost us more to do that. And so the state at some point has to recognize that, too. So when it comes to either the rooms and meals tax, that it proportionally goes back to those cities and towns that does raise it.
But the little towns, they love to get the revenue from rooms and meals, but they only got one bar or one restaurant in town. They don't have to give much, but they love to get the money back.
Oh, absolutely.
That's who we're trying to convince, and that's the difficulty of the job. I wish we could,
absolutely.
Believe me.
Other comments? Mrs. Wellesley.
Tracy, I'm not sure I understood you, but with the finagling, with the medical money, and now it has to be paid back to the hospitals and so forth. Do you guys ever ask who did that? Who started it? Who got that system going to bypass whatever they bypassed? Is anybody held accountable?
I don't know.
Done in 2012. It was the 2010 budget.
The 2012 budget.
Oh, but it was done before that. I think it was done when I was there the last.
That was a difference. That was Metascam.
Yeah. Same type.
I think what happens, to be quite candid, I think what happens is legislators go to meetings for other states, and department heads go to meetings at other states, and they say, "Hey, we got this thing going on," and it's like, you know, you put them underneath the shells and you move them around, and when you get matching funds, free money. So the states all put it in place, and the feds finally figure it out, and they come back and say, oh, you can't do that anymore. Where did it come from? I have no idea, but I think this has been going on ever since matching funds started.
Well, it was different, like Rennie says, I guess, but it was going on when I was there in the 90s.
Right, but that...
That hospital tax.
Right, but what happened is we stopped giving the money back to the hospitals. Yeah. We instead of collecting the money, using it to get a federal match, we just collected the money, got the federal money, and then kept it too. So it was
good business practice.
And I think part of it is some people do a calculation that a lawsuit's a cost of doing business. We'll get sued sooner or later, but we'll just kick the can down the road.
What concerns me, and a lot of this stuff, is accountability. And I have a hard time seeing some of that. And one other quick question in relation to the storm, emergency declarations and so forth for the winter we've just had. Governor Baker just came back from Washington, from Massachusetts. And he got, I guess, a pretty good compensation for the state of Massachusetts on the emergency funds, where we've been told that only the 2 days or 3 days of January storm are compensable. What are we doing or not doing in New Hampshire that leaves us out of the loop?
That's command to command. That's from selectmen, the town manager, straight to the governor, and the governor straight to the president. The legislatures don't get into that at all. We would have to have the whole hearing and bill process to be able to do anything on that. I wish we could.
The governor in Massachusetts went straight down to Washington today.
But our governor is not fighting hard enough to get that. If Massachusetts is getting in, we're not.
You didn't make the declaration.
Yeah.
That's the problem.
Questions for Mr. Emmerich. Mr. Bean.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, sir. And thank you again, all of you. You know, you listen to these stories where Manchester's getting $30 million in temporary funding that continues, and you look what goes on in this town. And this is some dated material, but you look at the administration of justice and protection. Here we are, we're juicing the state about $200 million out of 03842. In 2006, at the Merrimack headquarters up near the flagpole, state police had 190 people. In 2010, they have 220. In that same time period, Troop A in Rockingham had 56 in 2006, cut back to 43. You go on and on down the line, and it's a restriction of our money to be used for our own benefit. We're constantly getting a clawback of services. If you go to the websites and you go to the Parks and Rec, you'll look at expenses for maintenance right down here at the Hampton River, and there'll be maintenance expenses for $39,000-$40,000, but we provide police protection and fire protection for free.
Those are totally different.
Please don't interrupt me.
Please put forward facts. What you're saying is not correct.
These are questions that he's asking.
Point of order. Okay. So we're providing continued services on here, unreimbursed. We have our own infrastructure needs. The state continues to cut back. We're not gaining any ground up there in our legislative process. And it just becomes very alarming, and more so. And Tracy, thanks for that brief. And we see that other municipalities are gorging themselves. Other municipalities are getting more police protection. Other municipalities are getting more fire protection, where it's getting cut here, and we shoulder more of the burden. And at some point, Mr. Welch is going to bring forward an effort by department heads that will come forward to the selectmen about these types of costly services we provide that include pensions, that include health insurance, that include workers' comp. We heard our fire chief in here last week talking about he's got an aging fire force, the injuries that are perpetually sustained by these men and break down their bodies. And it's very expensive for us to do that. In the meantime, we're providing services for free. But if you're providing maintenance facility support to the state of New Hampshire down there, it's part of their income statement. People are getting paid for that, but we pay it for free. So that's coming, perhaps, from department heads through Mr. Welch. But the day where we provide services for free, then everyone should provide services free to the state. And thanks for that information, because it's clearly consistent with a pattern of abuse to the Hampton taxpayer. Well, thank you so much.
Just so you'll know, the Epping and Gorham
substation
motor vehicle facilities will probably be closing because the
state police.
But
budget.
Not the state police.
Motor vehicles.
Oh, motor vehicles. Oh, the DMV.
DMV,
yeah.
The Department of Safety got up to about 38% of the highway fund. We've been cutting them back. Now it's below 26. But in order to make their budget now, they're going to have to cut back on some services. I can tell you what the problem is. The problem is that the state, I don't know how many years ago, maybe it was when you all were there, decided that they were going to look to compensate people the same as the civilian life. Non-governmental, so they hired a group, I don't know where they're out of, down there somewhere, Hayes Group?
Not sure.
But what they do is, if there's a job description, they send it off to the Hayes Group. The Hayes Group comes back and says, this job is worth this bracket. The difference is that the benefit packages are so outrageously great for state employees, private industry doesn't offer what the state offers. The state employees work 37 and a half hours. The Hayes Group looks at a 40 hour. So the people costs of the state of New Hampshire, state level, not county, are out of control. Because in this biennium, state employees have gotten 6% raises, 2% raises in this biennium. We took out of HB2 any raises
for
the next
biennium. Pardon me, sir.
State employees have received 2% increases in this biennium.
In this budget?
In the current budget.
Current budget.
Received
6%.
They didn't fund it. This one doesn't.
No, we didn't fund any increases for...
the one that ends.
16,
the one that ends.
For the contract.
The one that ends June 30.
They received 6%.
Yes. Yeah. But the people costs in this state are what's going to croak the state. Because now we're paying competitive wages with, quote, civilian positions, big benefit packages, and less work hours. That formula is not going to work in the long haul. Something's going to have to give. And I think what's going to have to give is we're going to have fewer employees and more contracting work. I think that's the only way we're ever going to get out from under this. Because
I can just get a follow-up to that, Mr. And along with that, and again, from the New Hampshire website, in 2006, in the Department of Administrative Services, which clearly is technology and computers, most
no,
business...
No, that's DOIT.
Okay. Okay, but at any rate, administrative services, clearly that's one of the most productive increases in the labor force today. In 2006, there were 252 people in that department. In 2010, there were 312. So it's a growing workforce where is every business around here that's doing administrative services, there are fewer people because they're more productive with technology.
Well, just so you know how that got there, is what they did is they took services that were repetitive throughout the state and consolidated them. So you saw headcounts drop in other departments as that administrative services grew, just so you'll know. I mean, yes, it did grow, but some of it was taking over the work.
I just know as a business owner, most people are actually, if they are reducing those in other places because of technology, they're not adding. They're just consolidating the gains and the reduction.
Yeah.
Now, I have a question.
What about Representative? We got a couple that haven't spoken yet.
Yeah, no. And we're going to make sure we do. Your bill that you just talked about, that you introduced about the video.
The lottery.
Lottery
yeah.
thing. Would that help help towns from having to support other towns for their education?
Yes.
So that's probably what would be the benefit of that as far as Hampton is concerned.
That $212 million is budget neutral. It doesn't increase mm-hmm. the budget. It decreases the taxes.
Mm-hmm. So it would help Hampton,
yes.
Something like that. Okay. Representative Christie?
I'm going to be easy.
Yeah.
I introduced no bills.
A lot has been said.
I co-sponsored no bills. But on my committee, executive departments and administration, we handle basically two areas. We handle licensing of all, like cosmetology license, mm-hmm. That type of license, plumbing licenses, any licenses like that, nursing license, medical licenses, which probably doesn't have much of an impact on the town. The other issue we deal with is the retirement system, except that we only... The speaker this year appointed a special committee to study the retirement system. So two or three bills that were going to come to us to overhaul or make major adjustments have gone to that special committee. and they've retained them, so they're going to work on them over the summer and the fall and hopefully come out with something. And I have no idea what it's going to be. I don't know whether it'll be major changes or what. We did deal with two bills, and they both dealt with part-time police officers, where they wanted to exceed the 32-hour-a-week minimum, still leave the maximum where it was, but if they wanted to work 50 hours a week, they could do that, and we killed both of those. I mean, in Hampton, I guess there's an exception for you. They do it in 5 months. But that would have removed that exception and just let them do it however they wanted to do it, but leave the maximum hours still there. So I don't think, you know, I had much of an impact on the town of Hampton this year.
Well, I hope that you'll be able to keep us in your, you know, in your thoughts.
I will. I will.
And prayers.
Mr. Waddell, questions for Mr. Christie?
You know, sometimes I think that the legislators meeting so often just pass bills because they want to pass bills. And sometimes that's not good. You know, sometimes, you know, meet 1 year and do the budget and then meet special the next year if it's necessary. But that's good. So I'm glad you didn't introduce a whole bunch of bills.
Just one quick thing going back to Mr. Emmerich real quick. One thing that concerned me when you said it was they decreased the amount of overtime for state police in Hampton by half this year.
No, I said the state police detail.
Yep.
The overtime. That's the overtime detail.
Oh, they do it on overtime.
They do it on
right,
overtime.
Right, right, right.
Overtime, yeah.
Yeah.
Right. And
yeah.
They've decreased that by half. And that just concerns me with
right.
And if half of their force is not here
mm-hmm.
weekends like it normally is, that just increases it for our town.
Yep.
But they come when our police chief requests that they come.
They're here every weekend.
Yeah.
But they don't come. They cannot come down here on their own.
They're also here every weekend.
Yeah.
Scheduled every weekend.
Right.
They have a certain number of details here every weekend. Mm-hmm. And if they've cut them in half, then that's a concern to me.
Yeah. I've
comments,
heard it referred to as the brass
Representative Christie, Mrs. Wellesley.
It's high-ranking people that come in.
Representative there. Christie, you've hit on a very sore spot with me. How dare the state of New Hampshire set up a retirement system and then bail out on the communities? We are getting zero contributions. We are running shorthanded with staff. It's inhibiting our ability to add personnel. We have aging departments that are running short-staffed. People are practically killing themselves doing work where we need more workers, we need more employees in police and fire and particularly public works. And we can't hire full-time employees. It's killing us, and I can't see how it's legal for the state to bail out on its responsibility.
But, you know, I would agree with you, and as you know, Rusty and I are both members of the retirement system and retirees. But, you know, when the state went from 35% to zero as their
right.
contribution to the system, that killed, you know, a lot of the communities. And, in fact, that's one of the reasons we had the bill to eliminate, mm-hmm. or not to eliminate, but to allow the part-timers to exceed the 32
yes.
hours. Because in this one community, there's a part-time chief, three part-time officers, all retired. One's a fish and game officer, and the other two are retired state police officers. They got one full-time guy, and that's all they want to pay for, or all they can pay for. I don't know the difference. And so they wanted to be able to exceed it rather than have to quit in the middle of an investigation if something was going on.
I appreciate that, but with the burden that this town bears with the tourism, assuming we might advertise for tourism, maybe nobody will come this year, but with the burden we bear with the tourism particularly, we're dangerously understaffed. We have six firefighters out in workman's comp right now. We are dangerously understaffed in this community, and we are trapped. We're stuck in our ability to hire more full-time personnel. And I am furious with the state, the legislature, or whoever's done it, depriving us of the contributions that the state initiated. The state
yeah.
started this whole mess.
Oh, yeah.
Comments, and, Mr. Bean?
You know, they bailed, and I don't know. I mean, I don't know how you're going to get them back. It's a classic cost of downshifting, and
absolutely.
That was done when I was not there.
Talk to Tumpus.
And I certainly wouldn't have supported it.
Comments for Representative Christie, Mr.
Yes,
Bean?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Representative Christie, thank you. And I heartily endorse Mr. Waddell's praise for your legislative dearth. there oftentimes are too many legislators filing too many bills, and it doesn't change the game. So appreciate that, appreciate you being here tonight. Also, support what Rusty says, and he's got fine-tuned ears with his fine career of public safety. And the bells go off when these cuts are made, and they're usually unilateral, and like the pension cuts, and it's a pattern. And it's circle the wagons time, and then going forward, you say you represent Hampton Falls?
Hampton Falls, and Seabrook.
So we're counting on you to muster Mr. McDermott and the folk from Seabrook as we go forward on 224 next year. And can we rely on you for that?
Oh, yeah.
Working with these fine gentlemen?
Yeah, I voted with
wonderful.
With us. Yeah.
Wonderful. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
And I want to thank you also. And for anyone out there that doesn't realize it, he knows a lot about running a police department.
Oh, yeah.
Because he ran, how many officers did you have to help
you? I only had like six or seven, but you know.
And you did a nice job for Hampton Falls. Thank you for all that you do.
I wanted to be Hampton, I don't think.
And finally, Representative Woods, congratulations on your 92%. That was very impressive.
Thank you. Thanks for inviting us. I will be like Representative Christie in that a lot of what I dealt with doesn't really impact the towns. The committee I'm on is Public Works and Highways, but from a capital perspective, I'm pleased to say that the areas of focus that I spent most of my time on were things like the Department of Transportation. And even though I was a freshman, I felt, having worked for them for 7 years, that I was knowledgeable about their finances and how things work. And I was very concerned that too much of our money is going from the highway fund to the general fund of the state. And we've spent a lot of our time saying the 26% will be met. That will not go over a dime. The problem we have is the Department of Safety is spending a lot of money. For example, we paid for troopers to take care of the highways, which is a legitimate expense. But up till now, we were also paying for troopers to do investigative work that had nothing to do with highways. Uh-huh. Or we're paying for helicopters that are used to find people lost in the woods. All good causes, but they shouldn't come out of the Department of Transportation. So the budget that came before us was approved 100%. So they've got the capital. And for people who don't know, the capital is what pays to build a bridge or to build a highway. Their operations expense is what's used to pay the men and women who are plowing your roads in the winter. It's the operations side that got really nailed by the Department of Transportation. So I was very pleased that we were able to approve all of their capital requests. Every building in the state had to go before our committee. And I can say every department of the state is doing something. They're either building a new building, they're coming up with a new way of managing the court systems where you can do more online. All of that had to go before us. And we tried to be penny wise and not pound foolish. For example, if they had done away with the 4.5 cent gas tax, that would have affected the Garvey bonds that are used to pay for the major highways we have, and that would have been millions of dollars in lost expense to us. The other problem we had is the first thing we did is we met with the state treasurer, and he was very clear that he said, if we can't manage our finances, the bond agencies that determine what we pay as an interest rate for all of the money that we use to fund these capital projects. So the first thing we were told is, as Representative Rice said, you've got this much money, and you've got more good things to do with it, but you've got to stay within your budget. So I think our committee did an excellent job of not being penny-wise and pound-foolish. The things that didn't need to be done, we put off, but the things like highways, roads and bridges, every single one of their requests was approved, and I'm proud to say that, you know, we were able to do that. There are certain things like the community college system. I spent a lot of time with the president of the local Great Bay Community College system. I'm a supporter of that because those students have an extremely high percentage rate of getting a job once they graduate, and they have an extremely high percentage of staying in the state when they graduate. I'm not saying anything bad about UNH, but a lot of those students leave New Hampshire when they graduate. So I did work very hard to get approval for everything that the community college system was asking for. So
I'm glad that you guys said you didn't want too many bills filed, because as a freshman, I felt I should learn more than file bills. So I spent all of my time on the committee work that I did. And next year, I'll be more experienced. I've got some great teachers here sitting here. So that's pretty much
thank you.
An update on my part.
Questions for Representative Woods, Mr. Bridle.
All set. Thank you. Thank
Mrs.
You.
Wellesley.
David, great job. Great job. And you'll learn from all these nice gentlemen.
A lot Mr. of experience Bean. At this table.
Yep. Thank you very much, sir, for your service. Appreciate it.
And you're the wrap-up. You're a good wrap-up.
The wrap-up, good. Well, brevity and brevity, you two are the best. The rest are very good. Very good.
But we did.
Thank you.
We have a request for you.
Okay,
let me have my comments, too, please, for, Mr. Woods. I've heard that DOT doesn't even have a director at this point. Is that true?
They're in between commissioners. They have an acting commissioner right now. They're pretty much functioning where the director of finance has a lot to do with the dealing with the legislator and the financial things. The director of their operations is in charge of the engineers and the road construction and that kind of thing. So they're run by a lot of experience. I used to work there for 7 years, and I know the people who are running the DOT, and I take my hat off to them. They're hardworking, very smart people who are doing an excellent job. And the capital budget they brought to us, I don't know if the average person knows this, but when we build a highway, 80% of that funding comes from the federal government. So if we don't spend 20%, we're really losing 80% of value. That's why I work so hard to get all of the DOT's requests approved. And I'll say this. We are all represented across the state, and I'm fighting very hard for the southeast part of it, especially the Hampton area. As far as tuition that you had mentioned, I live in Hampton, and I also have a place in the White Mountains. Those are the two heaviest tourist industries we have. So for selfish reasons, I am in favor of keeping RED alive and well. But,
thank you.
Thank you.
And your
we have one request. Representative Cushing and I had a discussion not long ago, and we were comparing some notes with a lot of other representatives in other parts of the state that are very, very active in community television. They have a public access TV channel. And there are probably 8 representatives that have some type of show. And it was mentioned that you need a lot of information programs and so forth. Person that's working with us, who's actually, since he's not serving up in Concord this term, he wants to take some lead on it, and that's Chris Munns. And we'd like to work with Chris. And we would hope that we could get your support in whatever the efforts might be. We're just starting on this now. We just had this conversation not long ago. We'd like to be able to open it up. I mean, you've got the capability of providing
another public access channel.
Public access, well, yeah, but it's not a government access, it'd be public access. And individuals can come in, put on their own shows, and it could be anything from the seniors having a half-hour show once a week or once a month to political stuff, to other educational stuff that's more than the capacity of the time capacity of the current single station that you have. There are any number of them, and an hour's discussion between people from different political parties on a given issue. It's amazing how much information gets out on a free-flowing discussion.
Maybe you can work with our committee. Are you still there on that one, the cable committee?
Yeah. Cable Advisory Committee.
So he's
cable
your committee. Man to talk
and
to.
And the high school as well. Yeah. We think that there's a good possibility there. You want to add anything to that?
No, I actually just wanted, before we wrapped up, there's a couple things that Dave talked about that I wanted to bring to your attention. One, that relates to the treasurer. Draining the rainy day fund is the best, is guarantees that our bond rating is going to go down the toilet. And we were warned about that, and the fact that the House went ahead and did that just bothers me. That means there's no operating reserves. And the other thing is, we left $76 million of federal funds on the table and basically said, send that taxpayer dollars back to Washington. We don't want it in the state of New Hampshire. But I think I don't want to make a. I was the only. I know I didn't vote for the budget. I didn't begin to give some of my concerns that weren't articulated. I realize we've had a long time, but I think this is budget that's really bad for the state's economy. I mean, the biggest raid on a dedicated fund to take people paying their electric bills to plow snow makes no sense to us. That's money that's meant to be reinvested and recycled in the community.
When I came in as a freshman, the legislature before us, the two legislatures before us, had drained the rainy day fund.
That's
and so it happens on both sides of the street.
Thank you.
And it's an expedient measure that's not common.
Any other comments
from
the other gentleman that didn't speak as often tonight? Mr. Woods,
Mr. Chairman, may I just ask Mr. Welch's response on cable, if any? Do you have any comment on that?
My suggestion would be, if you're going to have a community channel, you do it through a nonprofit corporation, so the town is not in a position to be sued should do something crazy on the TV.
We're going to go to a lot of these other legislators that are involved with these channels, because it's in a number of towns. It's like half a dozen different towns that I'm aware of.
Portsmouth does it.
It did take us 4 years to get our second channel.
Yeah.
Comcast.
And it, you know, we've heard initial discussions. I've heard very positive things about it, what can be done. There's a lot of complexities in getting there, but I'm going to start collecting notes from the people who are involved with it. Nashua, Manchester, Londonderry.
Portsmouth.
Portsmouth, all kinds of them. And they are very, very popular in their communities.
I have a question, too, I wanted to ask you, Mr. Welch. This week I was speaking with Beverly Hollingsworth, and she mentioned that when the liquor stores were set up out there, that there were special things put into whatever the agreements were, that Hampton would get reimbursed if the town went out there for any issues that regarded the liquor stores. Do you know anything about that?
No, and I've never seen any paperwork on it.
Okay. Maybe some of you gentlemen, if you're sitting up there doing nothing one day,
I spent last fall on a commission that was dealing with liquor commission issues, and I can call the commissioner and find out.
Well, Miss Beverly did say that, so she wasn't really clear on it, but she said that when she worked on it, there was definitely language that was put in there that would protect Hampton if the police
had to go out there.
Beverly Hollingsworth.
Okay.
So she should know. Maybe it was when she was on the governor's council or whatever. But she did bring that into the conversation.
Mr. Chairman, I just want to say thank you to the board, and thank you to the town manager, and thank you, quite frankly, to the department heads here in town, because it's been my experience as a state representative that any time that I've ever wanted any kind of backup or any kind of sense of needs, that you all have been there, and it's really important.
Well, thank you, and we appreciate all you guys for here tonight, and I don't know what Nancy would have been able to say.
I'd like to second that. I've been in contact with a number of the department heads over the last week or two in preparation for coming before you to find out what they some baseline data that they could provide, and they were all very forthcoming, willing to provide more at any time, and they've done a great job. Fire, police, public works, they've all done just a great job.
We thank you again, and we're looking forward to Senator Stiles coming in. She'll come in probably on.
You never alter yourself.
Okay. You've enlightened us and frightened us at the same time.
Well, you should be frightened.
And all of you who haven't been there ought to consider running for office. Yeah. Run for the state legislature. It'll be an experience for you.
Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, may I address the delegation before they leave?
That's something that we ordinarily don't do. I think you already did.
We've done it in the past.
Sure.
The public has always had an opportunity.
If you can make it in a minute, because we have department heads that are sitting here waiting to talk.
It's going to take me maybe 3 minutes.
Let's make it 1 minute.
Well, I'll do as fast as I can. Richard Rennie at 29 Highland Ave. On the subject of building a destination gambling casino within our state, I'm not going to ask your position on this issue, but I am asking you to read and consider a little package that I'm going to pass out to you. I've been following the events in Massachusetts as well as elsewhere relative to casinos that at first blush appear to be a solution to both the physical needs of the state and a need for employment opportunities. It's a complex and sometimes, I shall say, a shadowy path from the conceptual idea to fruition. What I'm providing to you are my observations from reading articles in the Boston Globe, the Herald, the Worcester Telegram, the Portsmouth Herald, and bylines from other sources such as the Associated Press. The clippings are past 2 years' excerpts from articles leading to my opinion, and hopefully others, that a destination casino
in New Hampshire is a bad idea because of the following things that you will read in what I'm giving to you. The rejection of many Massachusetts communities for casinos. The questionable land purchases that have occurred in Boston and hopefully will not happen here. And the questionable reputations of some of those landowners. The failures of casinos in Atlantic City and elsewhere. Casinos requesting government bailouts and reneging on their agreements and threatening layoffs if the government does reduce the amount of money that the casinos have to contribute to the state, and they say, if you don't do this, we're going to lay off the people.
Thank you very much. We're
the
going to call it
for our existing tourist industry.
We have people here that
I
want to talk.
I understand that.
Okay, so you've had your time. Thank you.
Boy.
Thank you very much, gentlemen.
Gentlemen,
thank
if you,
you
would, please.
You can carry it on outside if you'd like.
Right, yes.
I get Rich.
Yeah. One of you.
Sure.
Thank
There's
you very much.
Thank
We're
you.
Moving on to Chris Jacobs, director of the DPW. I know you've been, you're looking a little bored out there, Chris. I know you have a long ride home tonight, so we'd like to move forward here.
No, it was all interesting. Always have to listen to someone else to learn something, so I was taking it all in.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Well, you can add a room on. They actually got that stock room.
Quiet, please. Mr. Jacobs.
Thank you. I'm here before you tonight to ask your permission to sign a conservation license plate grant application for this coming 2015 year. The signed application has to be in by the 24th. It's something that my predecessor, Mr. Noyes, prepared and left for me to handle. It is the same or similar application that we presented last year, and it would go to the same task. The Deacon Tuck Gristmill Historic Restoration Project, namely, I think, the roofing and the siding. That's it in a nutshell.
Okay. Do you have anything to add about this, Mr. Welsh?
This is a grant that we've been working on, trying to perfect, and as Chris said, we need the board's permission to present it as a special grant for the Moose Plate money. And it has to be handled separately under the rules, so you need to take care of it separately if you're going to do
this. I move that we approve the Moose Plate grant for replacement of Gristmill roof at $10,000.
Okay. Comments? Any comments from the board?
That's a good idea.
All those in favor? Unanimous.
Thank you.
The other thing I was asked to present, and I'll go back to this, departmental update. It'll be brief.
No, please take your time.
1 week on the job. Things are going swimmingly well. Very, very busy. The primary task in the last week has been we've gotten a number of bid documents out. We have, matter of fact, later this week we have a pre-bid meeting for paving with bids due in the latter part of the month. We have also a pre-bid meeting coming up in a week and a half for the High Street Lafayette Road drainage project, and with bids due on that, I think the last day of the month. I can tell you that we have significantly more interest in the project this year than we did last year. Combination of, I think, giving you a larger construction window. I've received calls from Brown Industrial Group. They did not bid on it before, and Dirt Pro out of Salem area, they're going to be bidding on the project. So I know there's a lot more interest on the project. I think if history repeats itself, it'll be a lot sharper pencils this time than maybe what was used before. So we've worked harder to get that word out there. I turned over a document earlier this evening to the town manager. He asked me to put together my CIP. Because it was, well, it came from five different people, and I was the herded it all together. A lot of work by Mike Doobie from the wastewater treatment plant. Excellent work on his part. And also a lot of technical information and support from Ryan Flynn as far as amounts of this and amounts of that. Even I was surprised. For instance, we have 9 miles of corrugated metal pipe in the town. all of it very aged, and a lot of it doesn't have a bottom to it. A lot of it we're having to replace. So we're trying to start a program to examine it all, assess it, and then work on replacing some of it. So he'll share that document, I'm sure, with you, and that's what we've been up to.
Questions, Mr. Bridle.
Chris, welcome aboard.
Thank you.
Thank you for already the work you've started and the work you're going to need to do. It's good to see that we're already getting out for our paving and drainage that we have, that the voters approved. It'd be nice to see some of that done fairly soon so the voters can see that it's getting done. And I think you're correct. We have a lot of pipe in this town that back in the 70s and 80s was put in. The corrugated pipe with a life expectancy of 25 years, and now we hear 40 years later, and it's starting to rot out.
It was the state of the art at the time, correct. And but environmentally things have changed.
Correct. So I think you're doing the right thing, and we need to let the people know that, you know, when you talk infrastructure, people don't see they see the above ground stuff, they don't see the below ground stuff, and the stuff that's below ground is really what needs some attention right now.
Right.
So thank you.
How do you do?
Mrs. Wolseley.
Ventilation in the wastewater treatment plant, Chris. How close are we to accomplishing something in that? That's a health hazard.
It's a $15,000 item. Mike put it in for as part of the CIP.
Yeah.
The wastewater access fee that we started last May has in it right now a shade under $85,000. And I'd like to use that to make that capital improvement at the plant.
Is that enough?
Oh, yeah.
I mean, that's a health hazard.
There's three major air handlers there, and Mike got an estimate. I think it's $5,000 for each one to replace.
Anything we can do to improve the air in there. And also, you have an aging workforce, and what's going to happen if one of the men either retires or is disabled? If something happens to Bobby Walker, who's going to know the accumulated experience that he has?
Right.
We're leaving ourselves so shorthanded. I know you can't wave a magic wand, but I'm really concerned about the extent of staffing, the shorthanded staffing that you have, and men working so hard over this winter with those terrible snowstorms, working beyond the point of exhaustion and working to the point of risking their health.
Right.
I just want to point that out.
Agree.
Mr. Bean.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Welcome aboard, and thanks for your tenure as the executive officer, if you will, and we're looking forward to great things. When you say, in terms of your bidding process, that pencils are becoming sharper and that more people are bidding, that's great work, and we encourage you to keep it up. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
And Mr. Waddell.
Yeah, thank you, and I hope things are going well. And I'm glad to hear that there are more people bidding and that the pencils will be sharper. I think that's really good for us.
Good for us, good for the economy.
Yeah, yes, that's great. So thank you, and that's all I have.
Thank you.
I want to, again, welcome you to your new position and, you know, hope that you're able to come up with a new plan for the future for us.
Well, when you look at the CIP, it's a new plan. It's a very healthy plan. I've left no stone unturned, but I do in the end realize that it's going to be a combination of what you gentlemen, ladies and gentlemen, feel the town can support and what the voters can support tax-wise and to get it done. But I have laid out a full menu of things that need to get done. And it's shopping list.
Do you have one more item that you're going to?
I hope not. No, nope. Just an A and a B.
Okay, great. Okay, thank you very much. We appreciate it. And have a good ride home tonight.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
And is Dick here?
Dick is not. He is sick. He called today to ask to cancel and postpone this.
Okay.
Oh, okay.
So we hope that Mr. DeRocher is feeling better. Moving on to the town manager's report.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. The town has received notice from the State Office of Homeland Security and Emergency Management regarding the declaration of disaster. This goes back to the snowstorm that we had in January. The period of time to be covered by the presidential declaration will be January 26th through January 28th, 2015. That's a 3-day period. That's our first storm. And I'll make the comment that I understand that the governor has requested that the entire storm period of all three storms be included, but no action has been taken by FEMA or the president in that regard. Whoa. We held the hearing today with emergency management. Two of our people went over today, and they discussed what records and materials we need for the filing for the 3 days. As far as I know, that's as far as it's gone. I don't know that it's going to go any further, which means that the majority of the work that was done is going to have to be eaten by the town. And that, unfortunately, because I have that figure here someplace, is $509,165. That's what those three storms cost us. On the good side of the ledger, the town deposited today into the general fund $227,646.88 from the health trust as a refund for the last 2 years and from our experience ratios and save funds. During the week, the cooler temperatures and added snow, the various town departments are engaged in spring and summer activities, regardless of the bad weather we had last week. This week should be much better. I'd like to ask people, because we've had a couple of near misses, pay attention when you're driving. We have people in the street working. We don't want to have any accidents. The tax collector has requested that I inform everyone that her office will be closed on Wednesday, April 22nd, so that she and her staff can attend the annual spring workshop to bring her and her staff up to date on changes in legislation, on court cases, as well as administrative requirements of the state. And I want to remind folks that the filing period for exemptions, various types of exemptions on property taxes, expires this Wednesday. It's the last day you can submit for that material. We are still working on the Selectmen's Goals. We have a plethora of material that was gathered from your meeting last week, which was very good, and we've received a lot of good comments from folks regarding what's going on as far as your efforts to set an agenda for the coming year. And I'm not going to repeat, although I did bring the municipal legislative bulletin with me, talking about revenue proposals and cuts, but I think we got a pretty good briefing tonight as to how big the slam is going to be from the legislature, and we'll just have to try to work our way through the problem.
Do you think that you could either call Senator Stiles or send a letter inviting her to come? Maybe she might want to come after something that's going on has already happened.
Certainly will. I know that I did talk to her today, and she is very sick. She has double pneumonia. And she, in fact, I didn't even recognize her when I picked up the phone. She was, she was so poor.
She said she wanted
to come tonight, and I said, please don't. Stay in bed. Get well. We want to have you well. And she said she would. So she will be with us sometime in the future.
Okay, great. And Mr. Bridle, comments? Well,
the only question I had is, I understand, you know, the governor has done that, but would it be a help if we contacted our congressmen and senators?
We've already done that.
Okay. Just to make sure that, see.
We also contacted FEMA, the regional director, and sent our objections or requests into there because that the regional director has a direct line to the president. We also sent a direct request to the White House. We sent it to all of our state representatives and senators as well.
How about our governor council?
We didn't do the governor council. We did the governor.
Yeah.
And because the governor is a direct line, the council doesn't become involved in this particular item.
Okay.
So we did go directly to the governor, and I think I've received the same letter of response now 3 times from the governor's office. They want to make sure that we understood, because we acted excited that we weren't going to get the money. She has appealed that to FEMA, and we'll see what happens. But as of right now, there has been no progress at all in the appeal.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Mrs. Woolsey?
On the news this evening, Governor Baker came back with a promise of something like $70 million for Massachusetts communities for reimbursement.
Yeah, he went directly to Washington,
met
with the president. And although my understanding is that the governor of Massachusetts, the governor of the Commonwealth, had in fact, issued three public declarations of emergency during these storms, where our governor only issued one. And I think that's the primary problem. The federal law requires a declaration of emergency from the governor before you can make a request for the funding. Yeah. So
Mr.
we'll
Bean?
See how it works.
No questions. Thank you, sir. Thank you, Mr. Rich.
Mr. Waddell.
Thank you. You're going to skip right over me, weren't you? That's all right. It's hard enough to give you this time. Is there any logic behind or rationale why our state did not declare the emergency? You know, why Massachusetts did and why we didn't?
It's strictly a governor function. I can't tell you. I assume she receives input from the state emergency management office. And whether that happened or not, I don't know. I don't know what the internal mechanism was, but it didn't happen. That's what I was told. Although the president has the right to override that if FEMA and the president feel that's appropriate. So we're hoping that FEMA and the president will feel that is appropriate. $70 million for Massachusetts, and they did not get hit as hard as we did.
Yeah, yeah. Okay, thank you.
Thank you, sir.
I would like to just add, this is just my thought, but, you know, almost all the storms came from the south, and I think they affected Massachusetts much more than New Hampshire.
Actually, we got heavy snow, too.
And yeah.
The Cape. The eastern half of the state. The Cape got really
The Cape
hit.
Got pummeled, yeah. And all of the storms came up from the south. Yeah. So yeah. They may have had more of a problem.
The Boston got 110 inches, and Newburyport got 116, and we got about the same as Newburyport, I think.
Yeah, we did.
So we did end up with more.
And I think that their problem that they had with their public transportation, too, probably.
The MBTA didn't fare too well in this process. So.
But if the storms came from the south, we can blame them.
We can assign sure. those.
Thank you for your report.
Thank you, sir.
Mr. Welch. Moving on to old business.
Thank you, sir.
More to come.
Mrs. Woolsey, you brought this forward. Did you want to open it up?
Yes, I think we need to set a date to talk with the planning board, communicate with the planning board, not to be mean or anything, just help them. We've got a lot of new builds going on. First of all, we need to coordinate what we're doing with water supplies, with snow, possible configuring areas around the town wells a little better. We need to talk to them about the electric service. We need to talk to them about private versus public roads. I noticed in one of the reports, and Fred had caught it, there's a road off Timber Swamp that's going to be built, and it's going to be a private road because they'll have a blue street sign on it, but they, I guess Public Works had said they could have a place out in the front, out in the main street to put their trash. We need to communicate with the planning board, and I think Fred's going to put it on the next agenda for me, that we will not accept any more waste as far as public waste pickup from associations and private developments and condominium developments. We've got to cut back on the waste that's being produced. The other situation that really has me concerned with the planning board is the septic systems. The development over in Timber Swamp Road, a couple of developments over there, will be having septic systems. Now, Fred and I have discussed this because we have no sewer going over in that area. I believe the state has some sewer access possibly for Toll Farm Road. But these septic systems are a big problem, and what's laid out now may not be relevant 10 or 20 years from now. And what are property owners going to do when septic systems fail and there's no room to put anything else in? I think we need a serious discussion with the planning board on the new types of development that are happening, and developments in the west side of town where there are tremendous numbers of wetlands, and we're building in the less suitable areas now, I think. So I'd like to have us get a list together of topics to bring up and start communicating with the planning board.
Now, the planning board representative is Mr. Waddell. Would you like to comment on that?
Yeah, I would. The planning board's an elected board, and they're elected by the voters. The planning board has specific things that they're supposed to deal with, and they deal with it. We have a representative to the planning board, which is myself, which was you last year, Chairman, Mr. Chairman, and I think that if there are questions we have for the planning board, they should be given to me, and I will bring them to the planning board and discuss it with them. I don't see the fact of one board telling another board what to do, or one board, you know, they're both elected boards. That's my feeling.
Okay, Mr. Bridle.
I think the as it was stated, they are their own elected board. We can have, I mean, I don't know if our representative will bring forward our concerns. I'm sure he will. But they are their own elected board, and I think we can talk to each member that are on there individually ourselves and what our concerns are. But I think we have to go through the process, and the process is our member on that board brings it to their board.
And Mr. Bean.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I support the representative to the planning board's comments, Representative Bridle's comments. We spoke most recently about lines of communication, the reason we have liaison and committee members, ad hoc committee members to these boards is for lines of communication and effective lines of communication. Motions and seconds render actions and executions here. I have heard no motions. I don't think this rises to a consensus. And in the absence of any motion or any vote, I consider the point moot.
Yes, and I agree. I know from being on the planning board that they are not they don't want to come here, especially to be beat up on, or you know, to they have their own time and at their board, and when they want to come, I'm pretty sure they'll ask if they can come and talk with us if they're in the, if, you know, if they see that fit. So I think the best thing to do would be to probably approach them separately.
I want to respond to that, because I think we get stuck with problems as a community because of some of the shortfalls that have happened at the planning board stage. And I think it's fair for us to try to work it out. You said before, or earlier, I guess before the election, that the planning board was open to meeting with us. I'm not trying to beat up on the planning board. I think we need to have a civilized discussion on what concerns us as elected officials, because we're the stupid idiots who get the complaints.
Let me tell you that I extended the invitation when I was on the planning board, and I don't believe they're going to be coming. So I think the best thing for you to do is to approach them individually yourself and see what you can do lobbying a little bit on your own. Moving on.
Mr. Chairman, just a point of order. I don't think it's appropriate for any member to call this board a bunch of stupid idiots, and I just would like to take exception to that. Thank
you. I think
you.
That's why they don't want to come. But that's another, you know, we're moving on to old business. Other old business. Mr. Bridle?
Nothing at this time.
Mrs. Wilsley.
Why bother?
Mr. Bean.
No, thank you, sir.
And I just want to bring it up one more time. Maybe we... Oh, Mr. Waddell. God, see, he's the closer. Are you going to come up with something big now?
No, nothing.
Well, thank you. And I do think that if we could try to find out a little bit something about those liquor store, you know, the history of that liquor store...
I'll look into it. I've never seen any information on it whatsoever, but okay. I will certainly investigate it. If there's dollars out there to be obtained by the town, I want them.
Okay, great. Thank you very much. Moving on to new business. Number one, waiver of purchasing policy, section 718:16. Mr. Welch.
Mr. Chairman, one of the things that was approved at town meeting under the Recreation Department funding mechanism that from the 20% that's held over from parking fees for infrastructure improvements was repairs to the Kids Kingdoms playground equipment over at Tuck, and unfortunately since this equipment is all manufactured by one vendor and only one vendor, there's no sense in bidding it because no one else can bid it. We need at least three bids and a waiver under a situation like that. The Recreation Department has requested the board to grant a waiver so that we may purchase the necessary materials from the manufacturer in order to fix the playground equipment.
Now, is this the old equipment, or is this, what equipment is this?
This material now is, I think, in excess of 20 years old. Certain portions of it need to be replaced.
And this has been here before the Board of Selectmen several times before, and there were suggestions made that they could fix it themselves and this and that, but I believe the only way that it can be done is to be only be by this company.
They are the manufacturers. They have all the templates. They provide all the information and material. Otherwise, we'd have to farm out each item individually and have it order, which would be much more expensive than ordering it from the manufacturer directly.
Mr. Bridle.
Mr. Chairman, due to the fact of the equipment over there, and they've done an excellent job at repairing and maintaining this over the years, but it is specialized equipment, company made, and in short of replacing the whole each unit there, they are still trying to repair them. And by trying to repair them, they have to get the parts from the company that made them. And so with that being said, I'd make a motion that we waive the bidding process in this instance so that she's allowed to purchase the pieces necessary to repair the equipment that's there and make
it
safe.
Second.
Okay, comments? Any comments? All those in favor? Unanimous. Two, approval of Conservation Commission acceptance of marshland. 2.5-acre parcel at the rear of Birch Road and along Meadow Pond, tax map 181, lot 30. Owner Barbara Salmon, by David Salmon.
Also move acceptance.
I'll second.
All those in favor? Unanimous. Other new business. Mr. Bridle.
No new business.
Mrs. Wolseley. Mr.
No,
Bean.
Sir. Thank you.
And Mr. Waddell. And I don't have anything either. Are we going to return?
We are not going to return, sir, until next Monday at 3 o'clock.
Yes. And everyone's planning on...
Minus one.
being there at 3 o'clock next week?
Yep.
Okay. Closing comments?
Nothing.
Closing comments?
No, sir.
And is the clock right tonight?
I won't verify
2100.
That, sir.
2100.
2100.
Okay.
It's not.
And is there a motion?
I'll make a motion. We adjourn at 2100.
Second.
All those in favor? Unanimous.
Nice job.
Thank you.
Very good. Thank you.
Nice job.